Good evening. I'm Richard Sommer, and as the Dean of the John H. Daniels Faculty of Architecture, Landscape, and Design, it's my pleasure to introduce you to tonight's featured speaker, Josemaría de Churtichaga. Let me start by saying a little bit about the Frank Gehry International Visiting Chair in Architectural Design. Under the leadership of Professor Emeritus Larry Wayne Richards, former Dean of the Faculty, joining us here in the front row tonight, 45 donors contributed gifts totaling $1 million, which was matched by the University of Toronto to establish a chair in the year of 2000. The purpose of the Gehry Chair is to bring an internationally based, highly recognized architect to the Daniels faculty to teach our graduate students, to engage in outreach to our broader community through a lecture and or an exhibition and or other undertakings. And actually, Josemaría is going to do all of these. Most of those active in the successful fundraising appeal and those contributing to the endowment, and many are in the audience tonight, so I'd like to take a moment to thank them for their generosity and foresight in establishing this award or this chair and providing us with the opportunity to celebrate the chair tonight, which, as you know, is named for Frank Gehry, the Toronto-born Los Angeles-based architect of great influence and renown. So let's give a hand to everyone here who helped make this happen. I just want to say past Gehry chairs have included Daniel Libeskind, Preston Scott Cohen, Merrill Elam, Diane Lewis, Will Bruder, Jürgen Mayer. Is he Jürgen Mayer H now, or is it just Jürgen Mayer, Robert?
H.
It's still H? Okay.
My phone director.
Okay. Wes Jones, Mitchell Joachim, Nadir Tirani, and Hervé Nijerk, who was here last year. As this year's Gehry Chair, Josemaría will be spending this semester and will continue into the fall semester working with students in the Master of Architecture program. So this is unprecedented that we have the Gehry Chair here for a year, and he will be also mounting an exhibition, but later. We're still working on the details of that. Keep you posted on that. So we've done something unprecedented, arranging for Josemaría and his partner Cayetana in practice, who's sitting next to him, to be here actually for the whole year, and they've moved to Toronto with their three children, so that's been quite a big thing. For the full Toronto Canadian immersion. In the dead of winter, they moved here. So I also want to say that Josemaría joins us from the IE School of Architecture and Design in Madrid, where he serves as the Associate Dean. He's also the former director of the Design Thinking Program at the IE Business School, which some of you might know of. Between 2003 and 2008, he was a design studio professor at ETSAM Madrid. And Josemaría has actually lectured at many prestigious academic and professional institutions throughout Europe and in North and South America. Let me tell you a little bit about his and Cayetana's practice. In 1995, with his partner, they founded the firm Churtichaga and Quadra-Salcedo. Am I pronouncing that right? Salcedo. You'll correct me later. Architecture. Since its inception, their office has designed and built several buildings, focusing mainly on public buildings, cultural facilities, and infrastructure. They have won many of these projects through national and international competitions. In designing a vast array of things, city council chambers, sports pavilions, libraries, cultural centers, cinema complexes, kiosks, housing, private homes, furniture, books, or even a town in the Sahara for a petrol company, they reject the notion of specialization in architectural practice and instead promote interdisciplinary ventures and collaboration. Many of the firm's buildings and projects have received awards and have been widely covered in national and international publications such as Architectural Record, The New York Times, and the International Herald Tribune. Some of their awards include the 2013 Great Indoors Award, the 2013 Lamp Prize, and the 2013 COAM Award. The firm was recognized as a finalist in the 2012 Public Space European Awards and received the ENOR International Young Architects Prize in 2007 and the CAM Madrid Regional Government Prize in 2003. And this is just a few of the many awards they've won. So, Now, a little background about what you're about to see. Many of us in North America look longingly, and with some envy, actually, when we see work as beautiful and accomplished as what we are about to see. Spain is one of the places that has sponsored some exceptional work and levels of architectural innovation in the past 25 years or so. And Churtichaga and quadra-salcedo are at the forefront of this quiet Spanish revolution. What is important to recognize is that despite the globalizing of culture and architectural practice, the specificities of cultural context and creative patterns of influence still matter. History and progress do not play out evenly across national and geographic boundaries. Some places accelerate and other places stall. For architecture and building, Spain fell into a dormant period under the Franco regime. But with democratic reform in the latter 20th century, architecture in Spain found itself in a unique circumstance. Eager and poised to pursue an unencumbered modernity, and at the same time able to take advantage of a building culture and economy that, unlike here, still afforded slow, careful, and craft-based ways of building, and I should add labor costs were for many years quite low there, this marriage of modernity and craft was magical. This is the environment that Josemaría's generation inherited. Let me also state that despite what might have been some political isolation in the 20th century, the figures that led Spain's architectural renaissance, starting the late 1970s, people like Rafael Maneo of Madrid and Elias Torres in Barcelona, were extremely sophisticated with international influences. Maneo, for example, apprenticed with Jørn Utzon, the Danish architect of the Sydney Opera House. So when I say we look longingly at Josemaría's work, and this is not really a new thing, for people with people like Rafael Maneo and other major Spanish architects of his generation, through the example of their work and through their teaching in the United States, influenced many of us, and we all wanted to do work of the quality we saw coming out of Spain, even back then. So like his mentors and teachers, Josemaría has sought out ideas and influences from around the world. Just one example of that is early on in his career, he studied with Eladio d'Este in Uruguay to learn how this really incredible figure conceived and built his astonishingly innovative masonry structures. And you can see that thinking in the firm's work. So again, what's important to understand what you're about to see is that like the work of Frank Gehry, which grew out of circumstances and influences that are very particular to Los Angeles, but draw on artistic and cultural influences much beyond that context, and in Frank Gehry's case, in doing so, has had an undoubtedly international impact. Churtichaga and quadra-salcedo's work has benefited from the firmament of creative speculation, economic investment, and built-up ambition that has fueled the Spanish scene in recent years, where the work has lessons and important implications for other places, even here. So with that, I would like to bring Josemaría to the stage, and thank you for coming.
Thank you, Richard, for these absolutely unjustified words. In fact, I came with the ice storm, so I'm not sure what does it mean. No? So, it's just a second, let's check that everything works. So, thank you all for coming to this lecture. For me, it's a great honor to be here, but it's also a big responsibility. I therefore want to deeply thank you to all those people represented through our Dean Sommer, who decided to bring me here. They decided to invite me for this position, but I decided to move to Toronto with all my family. So this year, at least, the Frank Gehry Chair has a five-people team. Two of these people are me and my wife and partner, as you can see in my business card. In fact, I left here a couple of business cards, not as a marketing tool, but instead as an index for the lecture you are going to attend. This extremely hard name to tell, Churtichaga and quadra-salcedo, Richard, is the firm we founded close to 20 years ago. In the card, in fluorescent text, we wrote a micro portrait of our firm. Let's see it closer. We make possible your special, spatial, empathic, human, happy, disruptive, thoughtful, impossible, exciting, thrilling, dreaming, emotional, deep, light, airy, experiential atmospheres. We are an attitude we defend here. I have decided to organize my lecture precisely through those terms, linking them with a more or less chronological work that will give you at the end the figure of this attitude we claim in our card. This is how we will understand the title of the lecture, where we find two apparently disconnected terms, technique and senses. The first worries us very much as the natural territory for architecture, the physical world of construction, methods, structures, science, and technical knowledge. The second is an unphysical territory where the way we perceive things is also extremely important for architecture. In fact, this territory always illuminates the first one and operates as a reactive. We love those two extremes, and we try to jump as far as possible between them. We think that architecture is the technical, not technological, art to build sensations. We are convinced that architecture is therefore experiential sensation translated to space. But let's go back to our card and to the journey I'm proposing you today. We have to go back to our first project, where due to our inexperience, in some way we were obliged to be thoughtful. Thoughtful in both senses, because we spend a lot of our efforts paying attention to others, and also because we also try to dive deep into things, trying to find the deep meanings, convinced, as Gaudí said, that being original means going back to origins. Through music, as this picture shows, one can easily understand that technique is needed to play, and also that technique is not technology. And of course, that music is beyond technique, but at the same time, music is impossible without it. This is, of course, applicable to architecture, but the problem is that sometimes we have to escape from our own profession and gain perspective through other arts to see things clear. In our first project, we realized that technique was not architecture, but it was the only path to reach it. Because through technique, you reach freedom, as a pianist can only really make music when he transcends technique, when he forgets it, when he goes beyond it. Arts then can be defined as a kind of meta-technique, and this is maybe the deep reason why art and artisan share the same root. An artist is, therefore, an artisan that transcends his skills. This is how we thoughtfully face technique in our first relevant project at our office, a community center close to Madrid back in 1996. We choose clay, the most common material on Earth, and brick, the most human piece product ever invented. It's also cheap, strong, light, warm, and a very technological material. But in our beginnings, we wanted to explore space directly. We wanted no mediators, just light and material. And we found this technique, reinforced ceramic, reinforced masonry, a system that allowed us to build in a very primigenial way, in a very primitive way in some point. A material that could give us in a single operation the space itself, the structure, the enclosure, and the finishing. It is a fruitful trinomium made of mortar, steel, and ceramic. A system invented by this man, Eladio Dieste, an Uruguayan engineer that I'd met a couple of years before our project. A wonderful man with a wonderful book, that work that stimulated me to build with it. But we had to learn how it worked ourselves, and this is how we started thoughtfully to learn and see, as the picture shows, how elasticity works, how masonry can incredibly bend. And this is how we solved this three-level building: a refurbishment on the left, figures, and an old rural house, an extension on the right for exhibitions, education, seminars, and a small concert hall. The access, circulations, and light through courtyard was solved with the middle joint. These are the two parts, new and old, joined with a small piece that articulates both sides. In the section, we see the old house on the left with a winery in the basement. The new addition on the right. We decided to build just everything new in reinforced ceramic. A huge laboratory for exploring this technique. Walls, slabs, domes, stairs, skylights, every single architectonic element will be a magic spatial single material. We used a system of domes for the new basement extension. The maximum span was close to 10 meters in the central dome, the ones that covers the little theater. Where we had, for example, to manage how to solve acoustics with any external aid, just with bricks. We accepted the rules of working with a single material, and we accepted the challenge. Just in cleaning the layers, we obtain an acoustic-friendly surface that breaks the sound waves and gives a rough central texture to the space. The other dome is interrupted by a reinforced ceramic stair that carries structural trusses as an horizontal beam to absorb structural forces and stresses. As you see, structure and space are the same. This is a messy scene of the cantilever stair. A stair made of two layers of brick, 11 centimeters thick in total, that after the human load test, give us a quiet image, because the stair here is also the inviting skylight. Above the small theater, we built a multi-purpose space for exhibitions and yoga, where we had the opportunity to push this technique as far as we could. And we invented and calculated a triangular skylight beam. On the left, you see the space and the sequence of parallel void triangular brick beams. On the right, the hollow beam detail. In a bigger drawing here, you will see now a very fast sequence of construction, a simple process where you grow adding little cantilever forward bricks, and where no formwork is needed, just a platform for workmen and the first row. The total span for beams is 35 feet. Once you get to the level, ceramic-like pieces are installed to close the hollow beam. And this is the result. The walls, also in brick but painted white, are sometimes strong beams up to 50 feet of span. Through the skylights, you see the tower of the Gothic Church of the Piazza. Another view of the same space, and the building in a very rural environment. In the old house, our obsession pushed things to the limit. Here, we wanted to trap the south natural light through a mixed stair beam skylight, supporting the upper floor of the old house, and of course, built it in brick. Here are the detailed drawings for the pre-stressed 65 feet span brick beam. It has been our biggest experiment in reinforced brick. Attached to it, a thin cantilever slab takes the stair up to the upper floor. Here you see the inverted long beam all along the second floor. And here, at a lower view of the beam linked with the hanging stair. Structural effort is there, but we hate to show it. Everything must seem natural, supported by light. After a basic technique has been reached, It was time to explore space directly. And the next project is an evolution and in some way a distillation of what with technique we learned. We wrote spatial in our card because against always trendy magnets, space remained the main theme for architects. It's our main matter. This is a picture of the internal structure of a human bone. You can see its internal beautiful triangulated structure as a refined effort to deal with forces, as an evolution against gravity. Space for us is between those two worlds, and architecture can be seen as the world translated to space. And this is what we tried in a small public library in a town 20 kilometers northwest of Madrid in 1997. Against the actual stacked floor trend in libraries, we wanted the books, the knowledge, the book as a symbolic element to be the space themselves, as in this paradigmatic project by Boulet, a seminal typology where books design directly the space. Almost the same as this tiny library in Madrid where I used to go, maybe a Sigmund Freud psychoanalytical space in my case. But after our technical training in the previous brick laboratory, we wanted the book to twist themselves the space. And this is one of the first sketches that the books dictated to us. A growing book spiral as the first spatial attitude. Still a formless space, but at the same time, a very specific and defined one. Where all the uses of the library will be growing around the twisted book ramp. Except the children's library that we decided to be under a star-shaped tree separated from the entrance and related to a patio. More a playing space apart from the other formal and symbolic one. An image of the main facade, the star shape for children on the left, the entrance between it and the main white block. On the right, partially underground, you can see the main lecture room scaping towards the park. And this red sloping brick element is the twisted exterior spiral affection. The cross-section is a very classic one. Main space, lateral corridors, but torsioned, with two cantilever slabs crossing in the air. And again, we solved any single element on reinforced masonry. This is the image of the interior, a quiet, gravity-less space where structure, light, and space is merged. The walls supporting the space are diaphragm brick walls with big openings for solving lighting and circulation through the spaces. A very capable and easy technique that doesn't need formwork compared with reinforced concrete, and it is thermically and acoustically much more comfortable. Here you see the facade to the park and the reading room with the tables at the same level as the meadow. The roof of the reading room has no supports. Where is the gravity here? Architecture is sometimes a perception play. We like to play with the eye. You look for the structure where there is nothing. And in the white wall, almost merged with the cloudy sky, we solved it. A whole facade acting as a cantilever reinforced ceramic diaphragm that allows a gravity-less reading room. And looking, going back to the central space ceiling, we see two slabs crossing in the air. They don't touch each other. 5 meters span, 12 centimeters in the edge. Solving the gravity, floating, twisted as a Möbius band, with these lateral spaces contrarresting the cantilever forces. In this era, 1998, internet was just arrived and was, of course, not wireless. and where the books are torsioned by the kind of vortex generated by the space in a slow ascension towards light. And now, going back to the entrance, we can see a completely different exercise in the children's library. Two doors, a small orange one for children and a big white one for parents, opens to a playful and vibrating space. A symbolic tree with light filtering through it, a ludic space to play with books more than read them, a tree to sit underneath as the first reading attitude. The tree is a steel tree, folded pieces for branches and trunk, and half orange tubes for leaves. The construction process, as I said, is a passion for us. In this case, we invented to draw with strings the branches directly in the air and build them as obtained, a kind of action space building where we measure and draw and define them at one-to-one scale. And then we build them without cut drawings, obtaining a vibrant space of reflections. The result is a vibrant space open to a small playing courtyard. This small library was included in the critical history by Kenneth Frampton, an honor for us, because dealing directly with the space, we were able to find a funny space in the index between Churchill and the CM Congress. In our card, we talk about light attitudes and architectures because gravity determines almost metaphysically the way we make it. And also because at the end of the process, any good architecture should look easy, as done through a light task. This is why we normally call naturality. The way we almost cancel gravity in the water is a bodily, always exciting experience. This is the way we relate with our space, through our body. And only when we miss something or our senses are confused, we realize about them. This is why we think those sensorial aspects are tremendous architectonic materials to work with. The dream of any structural engineer is to cancel gravity, to suspend it, obtaining a floating object with no physical loss. This is the idea on the next project I want to bring you, a swimming center as you could have imagined. The project is situated in the same town as the library, but it was a coincidence. The client was different and it was a national competition that we won. The plot is between housing and a football playground. The topography is inclined from north, top of the drawing, descending south. So we decided to situate the building, about 50,000 square feet, in the lower part to accommodate the scale, because it needed high ceilings and high span structures. This is the main level, showing three swimming pools, one for learning, another for swimming, and the other for diving. We decided to unify the space for the three and display the changing rooms and facilities along the perimeter. At the upper part, there were also the need for four gymnasiums to house different activities. In the upper floor, only the swimming space is attended, with place for sitting and a small cafeteria with views over the pool and the park. In yellow-orange, you begin to see how we try to suspend the space by defining a clear, long room containing the three swimming activities. A room that we designed through light to have lighter gravity laws. It is nice how in English, light has this double meaning. So the room through light makes the space lighter. Yeah, this just can't be said in Spanish. This is the room we made. Every pool have a different specific skylight supporting the activity underneath. Long for swimming in the middle, ludic or random for children in the right, and vertical for diving on the left. And also an horizontal cutting light in the wall, the yellow rectangle you can see in the whole perimeter, will act as a boundary between the suspended space and the topography of the underground. a room that can be seen in this cross-section and elevation with three skylight systems and the cutting horizontal light cutting we introduced to separate clearly the ground from the sky. Everything above this line should float, should be light, suspended, gravityless. Remember that we wanted to have this sensation and we tried to translate it to the room. The room should be gravityless. Quiet, as having a previous immersion in light, where the only gravity is the bended springboard dominating the scene. And this is the suspended room. We tried to move the water level to the ceiling, so to have a kind of double suspension space. The body, our senses, before entering to the water, have the sensations that you are entering a space with different laws, where no evident structure is visible, where only light makes you feel lighter. And this sensation is also bodily reinforced by silence. All the ceiling and part of the walls are finished in acoustic wood fibers, forcing you to remember the quiet, silent atmosphere you feel while diving. Our daughter was amazed in her first bath and needed the help of her cousin. But perceptive silence in architecture is sometimes very difficult to maintain. You may have noticed that there are no lamps or facilities, hardware, visible. This caused us a lot of discussions with clients that didn't trust an architect convinced that lighting just through the horizontal band, through the skylights from the exterior, and also with a lot of lamps underwater, it was enough. Now, they love the sensation of water acting as a lamp itself for the space. What users love from the building, as they say, is the relaxing sensation. Again, you see how physical themes are the main tool for architectural tasks. The diving are in a recessed place to allow space for diving. And the central skylights over the water gives you a reference of the vertical or even the horizontal. While children have a more playful light strategy for them. The public sees the scene from a dark room, a kind of foreground present all along the common spaces, sometimes overlooking the room from the offices or along the corridors or towards the changing rooms, remembering us that at the end, the people as designing for this family changing room we designed is the focus for architecture. From the exterior, this boundary between air and soil, it is also clear. Using reflective undulated aluminium to merge with the sky, to float in reflections, and the stone to attach, to soil us to the gravity. From the park, we can see how this woman is about to disappear. We also have to rapidly jump again to our business card. Airy, because non-specialized, open, roomy, generous, capacious spaces are sometimes the program, the only functional strategy possible. This is Madrid, a portrait made of the density of pictures uploaded to internet, which gives you a very good picture, a perfect portrait of a city. This orange cross is where we won a competition for a 200,000 square feet building, a non-social networks place at all. How we won it? Rejecting to answer the program. Well, in fact, not exactly. It was, as the Beatles song said, let it be. Let the program define itself. We think program is important, but architecture is beyond program and must be able to face changes in it. It is an entrepreneurship innovation center that the Madrid City Council is building in this nowhere's land. the outdated industrial area of Madrid, a vast, visually messy territory where the industry is still waiting and must evolve to the new business world environment. More or less in the middle, you can observe a kind of dinosaur made of bolts that the council bought, a heritage protected old elevator factory from the 50s. People call it the cathedral, 120 meter length immense space. An airy space that shocked us when we visited it. It was a rough, badly constructed, but an amazing void. A space that was to be filled with program, as the competition's bases commented. But against some of the other architects' proposal, one of them you can see here, we just rejected to occupy this space. We disobey. We prefer this airy, huge space to be preserved like that and find the solution somewhere else. In Cordoba, where you can see here how the Christians placed their cathedral, occupying partially the old mosque and not demolishing it. By the way, a very modern strategy indeed. We somehow did the reverse and started to find a lower environment to serve the airy central space, leaving this bubble you can see in the model free of program. Like joining two worlds, one old, rough, tall, and the other horizontal, abstract, less tectonic, but filtered, merged through a structural and screen strategy that grows around this yellow shadow of the old factory in a flexible program, expecting life and entrepreneurship to invade the space. A big, airy bubble surrounded by program. An image that is still becoming true because we are still building it. But the interior, the airy bubble we defended as a civic public space, is almost done. And the roughness was preserved as an essential part of the atmosphere. A beautiful silver space as an industrial memory. A memory space with color sparks and with people giving immensity to the scale. And some elements to boost life, to boost sensations, feelings, as this cantilever toy. A risky element that is hanging from the old structure, following the yellow lines like a graphic design exercise, but also contrarrested, stressed from behind, from this almost 50-ton weight. It's a color spark, a vortex again in the space. As this old boiler we painted in orange. Or this voyeur spy hole to look inside from the exterior. A color strategy that is translated to the program surrounding the big bubble as this restaurant still to be finished. Or these lobbies around the space. The color graphic strategy also goes outside, signing the elements. Playing with the city urban signing systems. As this crosswalk, telling you and showing the place to enter. The same that happens in the neighborhoods. A color strategy that goes even beyond to work as a kind of logo in the long distance. That allows the building to be perceived in random and chaotic urban scenarios that are always present in the suburbs. With a color pattern connected to city graphics as this yellow trash container in the left, or this pharmacy sign on the right, or even road signing codes at the bottom, or even the ruins of an advertisement framing scene. A color that is beginning to give identity to the place, as soccer gives identity to Madrid. And with this promising player and the fluorescent sunset illuminating the facade of the tower, we have to go before it's too dark to the next theme of our card. Here we defend experiential atmosphere as the way to define architecture. Architecture for us is not a formal problem. It is a problem of building atmospheres. Atmospheres to be experienced, to take us to the intangible as a possible building material. This is what we did in the Hub Madrid. We are now in the very, very center of Madrid, just in front of the Museo del Prado. The Hub is a co-working social innovation world community rapidly growing around the world, a place where new ideas and collective intelligence is happening, a shared space, but also a shared knowledge. They took us to this place, an old garage in the middle of Madrid. Almost untouched in the middle of Madrid, that was just a miracle. And with an intangible atmosphere that blocked us to design almost anything. We were just in love with the intangible, and we made an experiment. We used no plans. We went every day to the site to work with intangible feelings, with unique atmosphere there. We opened a little bit the windows to see and be seen. We add an acoustic and thermal insulation behind this wood piece's ceiling. We painting this ceiling in an atmospheric dust. We added a tiny middle level to allow small meeting rooms to happen, with access through an existing abandoned council stair that connected to other demolished buildings. We add a layer of comfort, a heating and cooling system underneath a huge wood floor, separating it from the vintage old walls and carrying electricity also underneath. We selected and curated vintage furniture uploaded from the community to a Picasa folder. And we brought different races and different religions to the space in form of random Dutch industrial chairs, maintaining the old letterings from the 50s already there, and adding just hand signing to the space. We also bought 100 wine boxes from a winemaker to solve the furniture. For lockers at the entrance or the library behind it, or even the kitchen, a space where we just overlapped, not built, a few layers. A huge CNC wood table that can join you and separate you at the same time. A mirror to remember the demolished twin space. As an immense value of time and moisture in this flowered shape as the only decoration needed. A shortcut for people in a hurry to go down, and a pair of mirrors in the corner. We just used the atmosphere as the working material. An intangible attraction always present. And that received a huge recognition by a fancy, cool magazine competing with Google and Facebook headquarters. But this watch from a French train station we brought reminds us that we need to leave this atmosphere but to a project just very close to this hub. To deal with exciting as a tool to operate with. Because for us, exciting is also a joyful effort to excite us, to move us, to affect us. This is a disturbing image that affects our eyes. Our eye, our senses, are important materials for architecture and can be challenged to their limits as a big central theme for architecture. This is our theme in the extension for the hub. What happened is that the hub was so successful being rented for events that the community there was suffering. They needed and asked for a space to work. And we found again a vintage untouched space. But the client said that they wanted a wall, completely wall-free common space. But we again disobey. Remembering, of course, Gordon Mata Clark, we did that hole in the wall just when the tenant gave us the keys. Can we keep the memory of the place, the trace of time, and make possible a connected space? With a cone from the door to the most distant window and a couple of spheres destroying everything they encountered, let's see in a short video what we made in a few hours. What's up? So the space is suddenly interconnected, overlapped, and suddenly transformed in a sensorial interface, where you are not sure what your eyes are seeing, if things are coming from this space and time, that can be a constructive case study, or a strange mirror with no image reflected. Can be a frame to become a spectator of life, and a door that opens something already opened, or a lateral vision sensorial corridor, or a space within a space within a space, or a design thinking up and running poster, or a struggling perfect place to negotiate with Hector, the builder. A disruptive, funny image for the eye again that makes us to the next theme in our cart. Disruptive. Disruptive because architecture evolutions and innovations always come from the way we reread things, the way we reinvent common things or already assumed situations and relations. And when dealing with history, heritage, buildings to be renovated for different uses, when dealing with memory, collective and respectful memory, can you be disruptive interweaving it, merging it with your own obsessions, with your own memories? This is what we tried in the cinema center in an old slaughterhouse in Madrid. Indeed, a very disruptive theme. Slaughterhouse and cinema that we were lucky to build. We are again in the southern part of Madrid, but closer to the center, where industries were settled till the 60s. An area that has suffered an amazing transformation in recent years through a 15 kilometers linear park full of activities along it. Part of it is Matadero, which means slaughterhouse. A vast cultural and creation center of more than 5 million square feet. We won a competition for this little orange part, around 50,000 square feet. From the exterior, it was like the rest of the complex. But from the interior, lacked the values of the other buildings. This was the part of the complex where the heating and cooling was produced for all the infrastructure. That was in a very poor state and with industrial equipment dismantled. So again, disruptively, how can we join the memory of the use of the building? The memory of the language of the future use, cinema, and also my own basketing methods obsession since I was a child. A basket fabric has an universally observed property, so known, but always attractive. It can be more or less opaque or more or less transparent depending on the source of light. Can we make livable baskets? This is the model from the exterior. And this is what you see when you open it. We maintain the units, forcing the program to fit them. This is the plan of the center and the cross section. From left to right, an archive for cinema, a cinema TV set, two cinemas plus a lobby plus a ticketing space, and a cantina connected to an outdoor cinema. As you see, we decided to use this figure foreground you see in the model as a strategy. The dark, the almost black, the background will be a single material that will solve the new program, a material able to become floor, wall, or ceiling when needed. The figure will be giant baskets solving the atmosphere of the spaces, a non-tectonic strategy that will allow an easy, readable intervention. In the archive, we jump from this Rembrandt painting, reinforcing figure foreground as a visual technique and the fascination of organic forms, to the entrance of the archive, where we see something happening inside. In this picture, the solution is exposed clearly. The background material will be wood still waiting to be painted in a very dark gray. And the baskets are geometrically traced using simple piping tubes. The archive basket is a skylight, is a stair, is a courtyard, and is a figure to cross or walk around. A strange figure made of fibers. But what kind of fibers? They will be simple garden houses, but in a simple, fascinating arrangement. They will be lighted laterally, extracting the almost flesh nature from them. They will be a lamp and the space at the same time. A courtyard, a stair, and a skylight at the same time. A passage. Tube to look into. Or a skylight and lamp for the underground areas. In the cinema studio is at the end a black silent box. And we use the old fridge to place it. Fridges are also silent boxes. You never know what happens inside them. But to get to the cinemas, we have to get to the lobby, where strong contrasts are present, and you can see the dark foreground when needed. A place with two doors. One door almost trapping you to the main cinema hall. A cinema hall at a very scaled space, where we wanted to become a lamp that darkens slowly when the play starts. But using, again, a basket for the whole space. We were able to leave all the acoustic layers painted at the forward, to weave a basket overlapped to the space that eliminates speakers, detectors, and all the visually noisy stuff, to obtain a silent and vibrating lamp. A world of reflective things and seat numbers that gets dark when the movie starts, leaving Cayetana here alone with her WhatsApp. But going back to the lobby, we see pink balls flying in the air and three random holes for heating and cooling. We hate grids. We love random as life. But opening the door, we find the second cinema, a more heterodox space that also is conceived for lectures and events, with a flat floor and natural light when needed. And the cantina, the bar, an essential and vital building in Spain. A space connected to the lobby through a huge sliding door, and where the boiler remained, the only industrial thing remained, an industrial witness. A place to eat and drink, and also a place open to the exterior as a possible summer cinema. Through this disruptive before and after sequence, we see the outdoor space, we see the corridors, we see the lobby, we see the fridge and the TV set, we see the cinema from the same perspective always, and we see the archive. We have to leave those memories here of what is now a vibrant cinema complex. This building has won several prizes, and even the Art Daily Building of the Year 2012, a kind of world social voted prize. But it was also published in New York Times, and this New York Times mention provoked what comes next. Dreaming, and this is why dreaming is the next theme. Dreaming because every architect starts in some way's dream, public and collective, or maybe private and intimate. A private developer saw the cinema center and came to Madrid to see it. Then he chose us for his next dream. We felt a little like that when we visited him in New York, especially considering that his dreams were big ones. And dreams always multiply infinite scenarios. He directly drove us to the site of his dream, to the Pier 57 facing the Hudson, a huge infrastructure he's going to renovate. And he gave us about 50,000 square feet to accommodate an event space, a kind of interim space during the construction. We developed a whole strategy to occupy this space, but he established a first condition. We had to work with shipping containers, because this is how he sees the future interior for the whole pier, a project already commissioned to other architects. As you see, dreams are smaller than you think. But we are extremely happy with this commission. For us, it's a sign, as those smoking logos we use to announce the site coming from the container. Inside, we decided to allow multiple scenarios for the space to work. And this is how we decided to hang 36 containers from the ceiling, like a kind of magic carpet, we call it. A carpet that could be transformed in any imaginable scene for an event. Any set could be arranged, taking them down and up with winches. The interior will be transformed through this carpet floating. It will be as we want, when we want, and for whatever we want. It is now being widely used for any cool event happening in New York. This is the developer's friend, and this is the space closing. And we did it. We made it. We opened it the last 4th of July with the fireworks. A floating ceiling of desires. A cool space for events. A frame to the Hudson. An uniglorious effect. A biker's stop to feel the gravity, the pressure, the risk over their heads. A challenge attitude to stay underneath. Or to dream relaxed as this man I found one day. A colorful, promising first move to North America, but not to America. Empathic, we say in our card. Because architecture has a lot to do with empathy, with the capacity to recognize emotions, and with the original Greek root that means physical affections. Cuba, La Habana, and the Malecon is a boundary, a melancholic line of empathic people waiting for something, observing the waves from another period of history. A stop time and a growing, impossible symmetry with the world. A kind of fuzzy mirror where we won a competition. To build the extension for the Spanish embassy, the new consulate. This is an American map of the old Havana and its natural, beautiful harbor. Just at the entrance of the port, where you see the Castel La Punta, stand the actual Spanish embassy, which has to be extended with a new consulate. The place is strategic as a proof that Cuba was the last country to split from the Spanish Empire. Just overlooking from the orange part the entrance of the port. There you can see the Spanish embassy, an old palace, and behind those trees in the middle is the annex plot for the extension. As diplomats are always quite old-fashioned people, and this was a competition organized by the Foreign Ministry, we made a silk, very formal box with all the info included, even a tiny paper model that we managed to fit in. In the upper part of the picture, you see the official document with the memory and proposal that I bring you. We spoke about Havana as a fabulous urban fabric. We spoke or were devoid. The street space is the real solid to work with, a continuous, fantastic, stressed surface of diverse patterns. And we decided to play with an also very old-fashioned architectonic tool, symmetry, a fuzzy symmetry giving you back the image from another time. All around a tropical green. We also spoke about the atmospheres that the screen tradition produced, an element to be maintained and reinforced, and also about Cuba as a wood promised land to take advantage from. And this is how we made an imperfect mirror, an instrument to reflect what Cuba and Spain should be. A kind of compared picture of architectures, method, attitudes. The new building will be a huge vertical wood screen floating compared to the stone tectonic and the rhetoric language of the embassy. We also made the joke to double the symbolic existing palm to also double the garden between buildings. And to open the main level to make a transparent diplomatic openness sometime in the near Cuba political future. The views from the roof are just astonishing. So we proposed a green roof for events and social relations. And through this fuzzy mirror, comparing a light screened architecture to the formal tectonic old palace, our project will be a pleasant, light, and filtered atmosphere all around. With floating large span slabs and cantilevers of reinforced stone, a technique that I'm actually developing. And a dense, big vertical screen of different tropical woods and bronze forming the whole facade. We will choose different woods, even yellow and red ones, to insinuate the Spanish flag, forming a wood open screen close to the old-fashioned but elegant diplomatic embassy. We are about to start the building of this fantastic challenge for us, a very symbolic project for us because we worked in Cuba for 1 year long time ago, and it's a country that concentrates emotions. And emotions, emotional, as we claim, tries to be architecture. Because as you have already discovered, senses and people's life are for us the main interface to experience architecture. But sometimes, senses seems to be a private world that cannot be translated to architecture. It looks like a black territory, architecture, senses, where we think architecture must be objective. For us, intimacy, your deep aspirations, are very often a universal language. Intimacy and private life can make architecture possible. I am not going to show your private life, but maybe a little part of it. It will let you know us better, who we are, what we think, and what we want in life. Something very evident in the next image I'm going to show you. This is the intimacy of our life now in Toronto. It's a drawing from my 7-year-old middle daughter, Juana. She did it on the house we are now living, and she drew all that matters for her. He expressed her intimacy, her domestic important aspects through it. At the entrance, she draws the basket already open where we leave all the gloves, hats, and winter stuff that is new for us. In the main level, she drew the mess everywhere in the basement that really scares her. She always rejects to go downstairs. She loves the flower always present in the kitchen dining area. And of course, dining and cooking. She's a very foodie woman. But in her level, her room, of course, is the bigger, even if it's not. The bathroom that's for her is also the only bathroom in the house because it is her bathroom. And a strange shaped mirror and lamp couple that we encounter in a rented home, she finds interesting. This is her intimacy, how intimacy operates, and I love to learn from that. For her, architecture is a container for life. And intimacy and private life is about our next project, a shelter we built for ourselves after a long wait of 15 years. It is in Segovia, an hour drive north of Madrid. This is a humanized landscape of meadows, walls, ash trees, streams, a small-scale landscape, minimal, almost domestic, and where absolutely everything happens in yellow. In spring, poke all yellow flowers. In the summer, yellow cereal is yellow harvested in a yellow Castilian heat. Fall only comes here in yellow. Millions of tiny ash leaves that die in a lingering and dry yellow. And in winter, yellow insists in glowing flashes of yellow lichens on the great trunks of ash trees. Even machines are yellow here. Tools are yellow. Everything is yellow. Even road signs are yellow. So we bought a medium in this landscape 15 years ago. And after 12 years of yellow contemplation, we decided to build a tiny house there, a familiar, dense, intimacy refuge. a piece of landscape at an intermediate position, as a frame, as a small inhabited threshold, a warm, domestic, and intimate threshold, with two views, east and west. To the east, a nervy view of rocks, cold blue reflections, fluorescent green winter moss, early morning winter sun, and brambles and ancient ash trees. And to the east, a yellow overlooking point, a suspended cantilever platform to enjoy the distance down over the yellow mountains, and also the intimate familiar life. From this double view, east and west, distant and close, and the tiny house where the thinking body finished to draw the house. Everything is small, everything is dense, everything has a tiny scale, everything is essential. Everything scaled to the limits. Windows height are designed for sitting at the table, for staying, for living, for contemplation. It is life what makes architecture possible. From outside, the view slides over the house. The eye only stops at two yellow sparks. A yellow gate guarding the doorway, and a yellow chimney that warms it. The rest is almost invisible. And when opening the door, sitting on the threshold, the house disappears and the world continues in yellow. From yellow to thrilling, because to finish my lecture, you will discover what risk and fear are architectonic materials for us. Risk is in fact a human attraction, a bodily intimate force. And size, scale, dimension of risk is an architectonic theme too. Fear, dealing with fear, is an overwhelming human nature that we tried to use in our last project today. A refurbishment and landscape intervention in a very old city in the middle of Spain. Almazán is a prehistoric settlement overlooking the Duero River that ends in Porto, Portugal, as part of the huge transformation that Spain has had in the last 20 years, the mayor wanted to improve the city and announced a national competition that we were lucky to win. The goal was to redevelop the piazza and to solve the traffic. In the image you see from the competition, apart from doing that, we detected the opportunity to link the piazza to the landscape as part of our proposal, and this was what determined our first prize. I am going very fast through the plaza we designed, a silent, quiet background for things to happen, giving importance to the monuments around the space. A Romanic church from the 10th century and a Renaissance palace from the 15th century. Building a huge ceramic carpet, a concentric carpet that collects all the water. And also collects the history of the town in this bronze drainage. We also solve a stair connecting the river with the plaza, hiding an extremely ugly facade. And we install several lighting strategies as a place to also play. But between the church and this statue, you can see a Roman origin wall In this wall, there is a hole that we wanted to launch people to the landscape from here. Going farther and farther, we made a giant cantilever to feel the risk and enjoy the landscape. A cantilever that was bigger than our intimate house. I want to leave you with a short video that taught us that architecture, at the end, tries to enhance and boost life. Not more, but not less. Questions? Maybe you are a little bit tired. I'm sorry for the time.
Hi. In terms of transparency, I want to understand more your relationship with the kind of modern tradition of Spanish architecture, such as Coderc or Alejandro de la Sota. That's my question. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, well, of course we have connections with Spanish tradition. No? I would say with Southern European or a kind of tradition that knows that invention comes from the past also. That past is not a place to stay, past is an active point to make pace and to jump over it. No? So I would say I'm more fan of Coderc than Sota, but maybe there are other masters over there. No? Thank you. Yes.
You talked quite a bit in the competitions about sort of doing something unique, doing something unexpected, even from kind of the client's or the owner's perspective. How is your relationship in some of these projects then in terms of working with the client or having them see your vision or see even what their vision might be different from their initial perceptions?
Well, that happens. I think competitions and clients are connected in some way. We were extremely lucky in Spain because we have a system that allows competitions. So the public sector announces competitions. Some of them are restricted ones, but some of them are open competitions for young people. So it's a tremendous, there's a tremendous opportunity there for new talent coming to the land, to the field. And what happens there is that the client knows what his dream is, but normally sometimes tries to show you how he wants it. We always reject that. We say them, tell us what you want, but don't tell us how you need it, how it will be. Don't show us any image, don't show us magazines. Please tell us how you live. Tell us what you want, your insights. What are your sensorial aspects that force you to do this or to challenge this? No? So again, trying to understand that architecture is not a formal problem. It's an insight problem. So this is why maybe clients and competitions are connected. And this is why we always disobey. We always try to see farther, to really change the rules, to break the rules, or maybe reread things in a very different way.
I think you've started. So I just want to
close and thank you for an extremely beautiful lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard.